This season of Merely Roleplayers contains swashbuckling violence, the threat of torture, and the exploitation of a character with impaired mental functioning. Welcome one and all to Merely Roleplayers, where theatrical people play role-playing games. I'm Matt, your host and producer, and this episode is the final act of the Cloudskipper's Captain. Go back and have a look at the map Strat created for this season. It's in the show notes for Act 1 and pinned to our Facebook and Twitter profiles. Can you believe we've only travelled from Sleetdrift to Grimspire? Strat put so much work into this season, and it shows in that sense you get that there's so much more waiting to explore beyond the bounds of what we've actually seen. If you've appreciated all that planning and world building, it would mean a lot if you could let Strat know with a tweet at Merely Roleplay, a comment on Facebook, or even better, a 5-star review on Apple Podcasts. We'll be sticking with a vaguely nautical theme for our next season, which starts in a couple of weeks, after a post-show discussion of the Cloudskipper's Captain next week, and the fifth drop stitch the week after that. Season 9 is going to be another bumper-length series, with two casts of players playing two different crews shipwrecked on the same remote and uninhabited island. Other than Ellie, who's taking her first season off since the podcast began, the whole Cloudskipper crew is returning, along with Vicky, Dave, Ellen, and last but not least, Josh, who we haven't heard from since Let's Get Gideon. As usual, the start of the new season is a great jumping on point, so if you know anyone who'd enjoy what we do here, now's the time to bring them on board. Speaking of which, it's about time to climb back aboard the Cloudskipper, splice the main brace, and prepare to set sail, just after this, from our friends at Kaiju FM.
Hey folks, my name's Rob, and I've spent the last 15 years working in the British film industry, making movies of all kinds. And my best friend Sam, and he spent the last 15 years being educated beyond all mortal means. He's got a doctorate, he's got a master's, he's the smartest man I know. And each week, we come together and we talk about movies. We talk about the colours in them, we talk about the characters in them, we talk about the themes and the ideas they present. If you like movies, like we like movies, we're here each week on Kaiju FM, talking about movies. Find us wherever you get podcasts.
The story's so fun.
The good ship Cloudskipper, quietly gliding across the top of the Arctic Ocean, this woman swings off into the darkness with the captain.
Where has she taken the captain?
Heading on to Grimspire.
This shiny cutlass with the jewels on it. This cool. Is mine now.
You are now the proud owner of a lightning cutlass. The pommel pops open.
Oh my god, it's half a map.
Bundling out the back is Evangeline and the captain.
And I'm going to scout out the back room and see if there's anything left.
Crumpled up on paper, the second half of the map.
I've got the other side of the map.
Natalie and I will get the captain. We'll meet you back at the ship.
Life's a game, the world's a stage, and we're all merely players.
Okay, so how are you getting through this crowd?
Elbows out.
Elbows out, okay.
Yeah, bustling.
Roll me burly.
Roll me burly.
I roll to assist as well.
Oh, yeah. If you're both going through, yeah, let's roll burly as well.
That is a 10.
Yes. Cool, so yeah, you can add plus one.
Okay, and I'm doing burly. 12.
Yes.
Oh, both of you are just wading through, just arms and elbows everywhere.
Moses.
People flying out the way. A few of them notice this absolute, just like cloud of fists and elbows coming out of them, and they just get out of the way. They want none of this.
Nope.
And you doesn't impede you at all. And you're out the other side and within a few meters of Evangeline, who's looking over the shoulder and is just like, how are doing this? And she's just going to keep her plan now is run. It's just her Elton seems to be taken out of the picture. she's trying to get out of there.
I feel like we did that in slow motion as well.
Yeah, yeah. And can I add that I'm just going to heft the captain over my shoulder.
Nice.
In like a fireman's lift.
Oh, you haven't got him quite yet.
Oh, still, come on.
That was just to get through the crowd. Like, you can. Getting him. But that was to roll to get through the crowd.
Okay.
Because that was a big obstacle in front of you because of failures.
Could you have like a number of throwing frying pans? Like,
you have a frying pan.
Like the little egg ones that you get.
Yeah.
We'll stick with you because this is quite a good chase going on here. I love how you've just taken what was a pretty big barrier just completely outplayed. Yeah. So that was cool. As I say, a few meters, you could either quite easily at this point sprint and catch up with them, do something, or you can try and do something at range. Up to you.
Sprint and catch up with the captain and Evangeline.
Okay.
Is that what you're saying?
Yeah. You can catch them at this point. It wouldn't be hard for you to catch up with them. She's tiring. There's trying to like push people off. She's taking a few blows.
Yeah.
You can catch up with them.
Yeah, that's what we're doing.
Okay.
Yeah.
So when you get there, what do you want to do? Because otherwise she could do something to you. So if you want to go in with the action.
I think Nat's going to go in with the attack and I'm going to grab up the captain.
Okay, it's kind of, it's a teamwork.
Yeah.
Dream. So you're, so Natalie, how are you going to attack, first of all? What's the plan?
Okay, I feel like I maybe dropped my wrench before when I got cut in the wrist. So I've reached in my tool belt, pulled out my telescopic metal rod.
Oh, yes. Yeah, can't we see what this happens?
Yeah.
So you
got a poker from really far away.
Rod it up.
Stay back.
How far does it extend?
10 yards.
No, I think it's like it's probably like a good 70 centimeters, mm-hmm, kind of mm-hmm. thing. So it's not too long that it becomes flimsy.
Sure.
And yeah, I'm gonna I don't really have that much flair, so I couldn't. I'm not going to go in there and fancy duel her. Yeah. I'm going to go in.
Oh, your style is very much more bludgeon.
Yeah.
I think you should leg sweep her.
Yeah. I'm going to go in, try and leg sweep with the telescopic metal.
Okay. So it is more like a police baton.
Yes.
Kind of. It's a solid thing, which makes sense because this is part of the ship. This has got to stand up to the wind.
And like you pull it out and then you go.
Yeah.
And it just goes.
I've put my goggles on at some point as well.
Oh yeah. Which pair?
the bottom pair. So
bottom pair.
Nice.
Excellent.
Cool. So roll burly.
Is there anything I can do to help? Could I use my look over there?
Yeah.
Yeah,
you absolutely can. Before the roll, because you might get advantage now depending on how well this goes.
Yeah.
What are you going to do to attempt to.
What none of you have realised is that Tilly's been in my pouch.
Yeah.
So I'm going to throw Tilly. But not directly at her.
Yeah.
Like enough that it's going to like swoosh past her face and make her be like.
Suddenly there's a midair cat. What's going on?
Yeah,
cool.
Yeah.
Okay, so.
And I'm going to shout, look over there while I do
of
it.
Of course, so roll flair.
Okay. I have a -1 for flair.
Yeah.
Oh, don't worry about it.
9.
Okay, so it's a mixed success. So you will get to roll with advantage. But I think the mixed success of this is. Evangeline's like a real cat lover, and any mistreatment of any sort of cat, like she was angry before. Her full focus is now on you, Ellie.
Okay.
Like as such an irresponsible cat owner, she doesn't know you've practiced this. She doesn't know this is
she doesn't know Tilly likes
deal.
It.
Yeah, she doesn't notice as Tilly performs like a perfect little front like somersault. And lands looking like she should deserve a treat.
Does she do a gymnastic land with her paws in the air?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, down, up, mouth open, waiting for whatever.
Tens across the board.
Yeah, exactly. It's all good. So,
a nod.
But yeah, Evangeline, the next thing that she does of any sort of kind of aggressive move is going to be directed at you, Ellie.
That's fine. At least I've distracted her fully.
Yeah. So you can now roll with advantage. So you get 3 dice and you take the 2.
Nice.
That is that's an 11 plus 1 for sword play plus 2 for burly.
I mean you rolled above a 10 anyway, so it's happening. So you sweep her legs, and what happens? Tell me.
Get down.
Tell me what's going on.
I sweep underneath. She lets go of the captain. Oh no, she like tries to hold on to the captain, but pulls him over as she falls over. So I've swept her. With the telescopic metal rod, I bring the cutlass down, give her a good old slice on her sword arm.
Okay, so she's going to take harm for that. Nice. I think with that as well, she'll probably drop her sword.
Yeah. And then I'm going to switch my cutlass round so it's holding to her throat.
Okay, she's just looking you dead in the eye, knowing that for now she has no option. But and Ellie, you said you were going to try and grab the captain and put him over your shoulder, so that's what
What's happening. So as soon as the leg sweep happened, I was running at the captain to scoop him up.
So he just goes, okay then, I guess we're leaving. So you've got the captain over one shoulder.
Yeah.
Natalie, you seemingly have Evangeline at your mercy.
Kill her! Well, that's the thing. I was probably going to kind of look to Ellie for approval.
I'm just going to literally over my shoulder be like, you can kill her if you like!
Then I do.
She is pretty unarmed. I'm guessing you're using your...
My cutlass is held to her throat.
Yeah. Are you using the lightning thing?
I don't know if I need to at this point.
I'm looking at how sad Strat is, and I'm worried that we shouldn't kill her because she's actually turned out to be
you've
a really
done,
nice
You've
person.
Done really well.
Is she going to be secretly my brother?
I'm going to regret this.
Kill her.
Do whatever feels natural.
Do what your character would do. Yeah. So if your character wouldn't kill her, then don't kill him. Kill her, sorry.
My character, enamoured with Ellie, would have looked to her for approval.
I said, if you like. Kill her if you like.
I feel like she's quite a big threat. I feel like I would slice her throat.
I wouldn't
use the lightning charge because I've got my cutlass to her throat. I don't need to. Unless she suddenly turns out to have metal skin.
It's all possible.
So roll, and this is being the big bad, I feel like there needs to be some drama in the seeing if you can or not, because she's not a simple person. She might have tricks up her sleeve.
Well, yeah.
So I think roll burly.
This is so tense. I've got really sweaty palms.
It's a 9 plus 2, which is 11, plus 1 for sword playing.
Yeah.
How do you kill her?
I look her dead in the eyes and just give her a clean, simple, nothing dramatic. She doesn't get any fanfare. Gone. And walk away.
She's going to look you in the eyes as she does it. And just before you do, a little smile comes up. And you kind of, in the moment, she's like, she found someone her equal. Like, she doesn't feel like this is, she went out the way she would have wanted to go. She was bested. You draw your sword across her throat. The blood plumes.
I walk into the dust.
She's already on the floor, so she kind of just slumps over. And I put a cross through Evangeline.
Oh,
I feel naughty.
So naughty.
Nothing.
Awesome.
I wanted to dramatically walk away and then be like, I should check her body. Does she have anything important?
I think with that, though, like, now there's been a murder in the middle of the street, all this fighting, all that, there's no real law here, but the more senior people in the House of the Grey Vultures, like, they try and keep order. It's like piratical justice. But those people are coming and they're like cracking skulls with their cudgels and trying to break things up. And someone is going to have spotted that happening.
Yeah.
And so there's, like, killing someone like that in the middle of the street gets attention. So there's some shouts, there's some pointing at you, at the person next to her with someone over their shoulder.
I am running with the captain.
The distance, running back to the ship. Alex and Chris, you've just witnessed this happen.
I'm probably on the floor at the moment because I'm...
Oh, yeah, you haven't witnessed it. You're still...
I'm still in the melee.
I think you've spent this time kind of crawling out.
Okay, so I'm just like
with your hands over your head to protect you, and you sort of, like, jump out of the thing. You see... You're just in time to see Natalie's putting the final nail in Evangeline's coffin. So you are ejected from the crowd. Chris, you are also free from the crowd. What are you two doing?
I'd like to go to Elton and just lean down towards him and go... You chose the wrong crew. and I'm going to kill him.
He has taken so much harm at this point. If you were to do that, he's got no way of stopping you. So he's just going to go, wait!
Bang. And I turn to Jim and I say, tell Quintus that the crew of the Cloudskipper did a thing we needed to do. The captain needed us.
And
Quintus wasn't there.
Oh.
He just looks at you and kind of just nods his head and yeah. I'll let him know. And he legs it.
And when he goes,
he doesn't want anything.
Ooh. And I sort of hop about a little bit, thinking really proud of myself. I did something really piratey.
Really piratey?
And I is it quite a perilous environment?
At the moment, I would say, like, it's all ruckus. You two can quite happily extricate yourself from the situation. I think, Ellie and Natalie, you're going to be able to get away. Like, you're known, but no one's really close enough. They're all in the melee. Mm. So you can all get back to wherever you're on the food.
Yeah,
yeah. Shit.
I'll make my way to Alex and I pick him up and then...
Yeah.
Okay, so you're all...
So is it running, like, me with the captain over my shoulder and you with Alex over your shoulder?
No, I sort of, sorry, I help him up and then we...
Yeah, okay. So you're all barreling through the marketplace. Yeah. You run past Jedi, Jury's concealed weapons, and she kind of looks at you as you run past this person over your shoulder and kind of just gives a bit of a wave.
Yeah.
Just like, oh, probably went all right for them then. You back through the market, up the stairs, burst out into the up thing in your run, and you make it back to your ship. And that's the end of that scene. Okay, so you all arrive back at your ship, the Cloudskipper, all very much out of breath. Captain flung over your shoulder, just kind of bubbly along, enjoying the ride. A little bit dazed, probably. As you get on there, Cobb is on the deck, and he's just about to like impress you with all the upgrades he's done, and then he goes, "Oh, bloody hell, you got the captain!" He's just... astound, like massive smile on his face. He was expecting you to come back with a bit of information. India is at the helm. She runs over, kind of takes the captain down off your shoulder, kind of gives him a big hug. They're really happy to see him. She's sort of like she says, "I shall take him down to his cabin. He's probably in need of a rest."
Yeah, he probably needs a nap, doesn't he?
Cobb informs you that Amory and the others, they knew a few people in port that could look after dangerous folk. So they've got them off the ship for you. So they are no longer a problem. And your ship is equipped with heavy cannon and a ram.
Oh, nice.
What, data?
So a big metal spike has been welded onto the front. Essentially just allows you to drive into stuff.
Woohoo!
And batter other ships. Choo-choo. With your ship.
Can it form the shape of like a sky dog, but with like a spike coming out as its tongue or something?
Yeah. Yeah, it definitely can. Its tail kind of comes... It's kind of more like how the figurehead would work.
Yeah,
this but is, spiky.
This is, it's very ornate. Cobb looks at it really kind of happy. Kind of gets a sense it's probably had a hand in making it.
Great job, Cobb.
Cobb? Now we've known each other for a long time, you and I.
We have, Chris. Yeah, we have.
And I must say, I've been very impressed with your girl, Natalie.
Well, she's a hard worker. Knows her way around a sky vessel, for sure. One of the best, I'd say.
I think she's done a good job.
I kind of sidle over and kind of nudge him and smile at you in a kind of don't tell him kind of way.
She didn't kill anyone.
Cobb gives you a look. It turns out good to see you back now.
Thanks, Cobb.
I'll get things ready. I guess I don't know what are we going? What are we doing?
Yeah, the other piece of information is we've got the other half of the map. So let's crack on, weigh anchor.
He's like, all right then. Yeah, let's do this. And there's still a couple of the crew that you were playing cards with or whatever. Mm. They seemingly weren't involved in the mutiny. They've been
crew
very
number one.
Confused what's going on.
And
he starts kind of calling orders. All right then, Alex. I guess we better chart a course, eh?
Yeah, absolutely.
Where are we headed?
We're heading to the archipelago, the Windsea Archipelago. Do you know the largest island? No worries if not. It's all on the maps. I'll be able to chart it, not a problem.
Yeah, I mean, charts aren't really my thing. That's that's what Rosemary
did,
really, wasn't it? It kind of was a bit of a little...
It will notice as well, chaps.
Absolutely. I'll get down chart course and relay that to
our new helmsman.
Well, there's no one else who's going to do it. Be my guest, I suppose.
I'm the helmsman.
Congratulations, Mr. Storkey. And I start planning a cake in my head.
I pass over my spyglass to you.
Alex, I don't know how long I've waited for this.
We all need to know where you're going. I take... who's got the two-way communicator?
It's still me.
It's still I've got you, one so as well, so I give... So
I take, yeah, I take one off that. You and scramble up to the crow's nest.
Okay, you're on the crow's nest. I think you've probably given Chris your map with a kind of a route plotted on it. Pretty good route, but Chris, you're going to need to roll to sail this thing. roll sea legs, and because Alex has been able to give you a route, and I'm not going to make you roll to see if you can work out a route because you have a good map, you have an understanding, you've got a close-up of it. Mm-hmm. So you've got advantage on, this, because... Alex has given you good direction.
Come on, baby, come on. Oh, shit.
Oh, no.
Shit the bed.
Right,
so that's three twos. So I'm going to take these two twos.
And you plus
and I'm going to
sea
add
legs.
One.
So that's a five. So you get there, but this is very much your first time piloting a boat. You hit some reefs. You head straight into quite a bad storm for a couple of days that Alex did point out. You go around in circles for a bit. You've probably been at sea for like a good 3 weeks by the time you get there. People aren't particularly happy with you, but you make it. The ship has taken a battering, and your position as helmsman is rocky. But everyone knows there's really no one else that can do it. So
to deck rest.
So you're still a helmsman for now. They'll see how the home journey goes before any decision is made on promotion. But the captain seems pretty happy. He's spent most of his time kind of recovering in his days. It was kind of quite an ordeal for him, so he spent a good few days recovering, and then is back now to his kind of old.
Has he got some like toy ships that he plays with?
Yeah. He's been in his cabin, kind of reliving
the glory days.
Glory days.
Because he makes up little voices and like moves them around and plays with them.
Pew pew.
Yeah,
pew, pew.
Yeah, he's wins. He's really happy.
Aww.
He's come out quite well. But you arrive there, and so you. No, from the map there is this. Well, actually, no. Where do you want to? Where do you want to land?
I think we should go for the X that's got a circle around it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm firmly in agreement with that.
Slap bang in the middle in the mountains, by the looks of it.
Yep.
So, where would you like to moor?
Think we land here.
Okay, round the kind of south side,
and then we can go straight up the mountains rather than have to walk across here or across here. That's the closest route.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe it's probably the closest.
Don't want to really land by the monster.
No, obviously.
Void that. Not quite sure if that's embellishment or...
that's
where it lives.
I've engineered together some, like, climbing gear for us to maybe help out, like, some ropes.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah.
I think you've put together a good kind of, things. You're not going to have trouble scaling stuff. I think the way it was is, like, Alex climbs up, like, and he's, like, puts putting in pittons, all the things that you've made to kind of... build up, so you've kind of provided all this stuff to help you job things. So you get there. I think let's see how you're going to get there, but let's see how successful you are at following the map and seeing if you can actually find out where it is. So who would like to lead?
Probably me, because I can navigate through dangerous territory.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to do that. I don't know what my novice skill actually means that I can do, but, you know, it means I can navigate through.
So that was the sort of, so you can navigate through, perilous terrain, so you can look out for things that can be a threat and kind of stop that from happening. Yeah, that is, that's a cunning role, so you can keep an eye out. You're kind of looking sharp-eyed, making sure that, pointing out potentially, like, loose rocks and things like that.
Like a hazard perception test.
Yeah, agree with
that. I'm just clicking on things. Oh, that looks dangerous. What's that pedestrian doing there?
Double six.
Alex, tell us briefly about your epic journey toward and then up the mountain. What's this journey like?
Well, it's actually, because of my expert navigation, quite perilous. I'm happy with that. So nothing too bad occurs because I managed to pick the right spots to climb up, the safest places to put the pitons in. I show some of the nice scenery. We get to see some animals, some flora, some fauna. It's educational. Someone could have done a PowerPoint on it. And then we eventually get to the destination
so
we're headed to.
As you're going through, and you'll point out all floor and floor and everything. The sort of like the captain's general demeanor has gone from kind of like general just good natured bumbling around to sort of every now and again kind of flashes of kind of realization or and kind of noticing things. You kind of see like he's recognizing stuff.
Mm-hmm.
He knows things. And the further you go on, the kind of more right, and you kind of get to a bit of mountain. He's like, oh, I didn't know we were coming back here.
I'm going to have a little chat with him, maybe. See if we can get anything out of his brain. Yeah?
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Hello there, Ellie. Is it lunchtime already?
I've brought you a little snack. It's one of those nice biscuits you like.
Oh, I do love a biscuit. Thank you.
You have a nibble on that.
Oh, I will.
So you seem to be recognising where we are a little bit.
Yes, I've been here before. There was this... One of those... It's kind of a lock thing, and then there was this kind of big door, really big, odd door.
Are you right? Do you know what was behind the door?
Oh, something very important. Something. I was going to come back for it. I never did.
You're right. Well, I suppose we're back now, aren't we?
Hmm. Yeah, it was definitely around here somewhere.
Well, that's good to know. Is there
maybe we should look for it.
Oh boy! What a good idea, Captain.
Lucky we're here, really.
We can't let everybody know that we're now looking for it.
Oh, if you could. Yes, it's been a while since I gave an order.
Yes, I will.
Everybody, we're looking for something.
Okay, good.
Not sure what it is, but do your best. Your captain needs you.
Aye, aye, Captain.
And he kind of just sort of like looks and kind of wanders off. Not necessarily like he's looking, more like he's following a path he doesn't even know he's taking.
Mm. I reckon we should follow the captain. I don't think he knows what he's doing, but I think he's somehow instinctively remembering. I'm at risk now of sounding like Alex, I understand, but I think that somewhere deep down he knows where he's going.
So he walks around the mountain and kind of maybe about half an hour of him kind of just wandering around and occasionally asking if you'd found it yet. And you come out into kind of this kind of hidden grove with a massive waterfall that's coming down from the top of the mountains.
Well, I think from everything I know from this trip that we should go behind the waterfall.
If someone's going to put a waterfall there, you have to go behind it. And if there's nothing behind it, you kill the person who wrote it. That's how that rolls.
Sure.
It's a hard line, but I agree.
So you're going behind the waterfall?
Yeah. It's a good job we brought our wet weather gear.
Yeah, exactly. Your hoods are up as you go underneath it.
I didn't bring mine.
the mechanism of your hidden weapon starts getting a little bit, and you're like, oh, I better cover that up so it doesn't get rusty.
I've never been cleaner.
Yes.
Aww.
You come out, you barely recognise Chris as he comes out of the other side.
Colour hair.
Blonde.
Oh, it wasn't colour, it was just dirt all along.
Oh
dear. So yes, you step through the waterfall and there's a tunnel that leads down.
Alright, I'm going to activate my headlamp.
Yes!
This is good because there is no light, so you have a light source. It's very slippery underfoot.
Those crocs will come in handy.
Non-slip crocs.
Yeah, I'm fine.
So the captain's like, oh, this past... Yes! Now, I lost a man down here. Did I lose him? Did he come back?
I start getting the ropes out and making sure that I'm banging them into the wall so that we can make our way safely back up.
Always on the left-hand side.
Yeah.
I think it might be a bit of an Indiana Jones situation potentially as well. Uh-oh. So maybe have your... magic stick extended, Nat.
Yeah.
And then you can just sort of poke it a bit in front of you, and then if there's booby traps, they'll won't get you.
So you're actively looking for some sort of peril.
Mm.
Who's doing the? Is that you, Natalie?
I guess. I'm at the front. I've got the head torch, so people can see ahead of me.
So roll savvy, and I will give you a plus one for your head torch. Cool. That's helping you out. So plus one and the two savvy.
Oh, no.
Four total.
That's a four.
Not dying.
So
technically these are not booby traps, they're booty traps.
Oh.
So as you go through, you're kind of walking and you found yourselves kind of going ahead of the captain a little bit. And he's kind of behind and you just hear a click and he goes, oh, and you suddenly hear a collapse behind you, and any light from behind you has now disappeared. and you are now seemingly that you're not going out the way you came in necessarily.
Is the captain the other side?
No, no, he's still there. Okay. He kind of turns around and goes, I don't remember, a big pile of rocks. Never mind. And kind of walks forward.
So there's been a big tunnel collapse behind us.
Yes, the tunnel is now inaccessible behind you.
Was that because I tapped something with my stick?
And you just didn't find the thing. You didn't find it when you were looking. He stood on it.
Nods.
Poor guys.
So the only way ahead now is forwards. The only way ahead. The only way ahead is ahead. Gotta get ahead to get ahead.
That is what the captain says.
Yes, that is very much.
Best way is forward.
There he goes, onwards, crew. By the way, is Cobb and India with you? We haven't mentioned it. Are they looking after the ship or are they with you?
They'll be at the ship, I reckon.
Cobb's got to be fixing all of the damage that's been incurred by our shoddy helmsman.
Yeah, okay. And so India's probably there just to keep guard just in case. So
do you think
just,
we need a couple of nameless crew that can die instead of us?
Red shirt, one.
So, red shirt, one, and,
They're there to
Reggie and Ronnie.
Carry stuff.
Yeah. Reggie and Ronnie, red shirt, are both, both there. They look a bit, I hope we can get out. It's like, we're fine, they save the captain, they can do anything, they can, they'll get us out. You've got a head onwards.
Mm-hmm.
And eventually, after a little bit more walking, you come across what looks like a huge door, like, buried into the rock.
Just like the captain foretold.
He goes, that's the one! That's the door! Now, we opened it last time, didn't we? Yes, me and Evangeline, we opened it up. We opened it up and then, we definitely opened it up. And so he's going to kind of go ahead. So it's a massive door. It looks like you'll recognise kind of machinery. There are kind of like doors that can be secured through electric means. Obviously, there was that one in the ship that opened up. But Natalie, you notice a lot of this technology, although on a much bigger scale, just looking at it, kind of reminds you a bit of the sword. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so I do have my jeweled cutlass with me. So
we might be very glad that you haven't discharged the lightning so far.
All right. Eyebrow waggle. Okay, so we're gonna look around. Mm-hmm. I might give someone my lightning welder as an extra light in the room to help looking. Maybe someone wants to take my lightning. Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. So Ellie.
So you're all kind of Ellie. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You're looking. So
it's a lovely bit of kit. I could use this to do some flambéing.
Creme brulee.
So you're all looking around. I think what happens. I think you're going to find this. We're not going to present you a door and not go through. So I'm not going to make you roll for it.
That'd be a very shit end.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. There's no danger. There's no reason why with
and
enough
you
time
die in a tunnel.
You can find it. But I think what happens is Alex, you've been like looking a little bit higher up, and you find. You find off to one side and kind of further up the wall this kind of round circular metal plate, and in it, a kind of a thin slot.
I shout this down to Nat. No. I think I found what we're looking for. Pass me up the sword.
I'm a bit hesitant to give you my sword, but I chuck it up.
I catch it.
Roll flare.
I'm standing right underneath.
If you're going to throw something up in the air for someone else to catch.
Oh, Jesus. Of all the people to catch it now, Alex is the one, surely.
So that's a seven. So you catch it.
Okay.
But
with
very much like Chris earlier, you're going to have matching scars because you're going to catch it by the blade.
Sorry.
Yeah, the throw wasn't great.
It was your fault.
You kind of just like, it wasn't going to be the marvellous, dramatic grabbing it and thrusting it straight in. And
you just hear me go, ah!
Yeah.
I yell catch after I
throw it. So yeah, you've got it. You've like,
also, we're kind of in the dark as well.
Yeah, not much light. It's not a surprise. You're a bit high up. You just kind of wipe the blood off on your shirt.
Yeah.
But you'll have to get rid of it later. But you have the sword, so what do you do?
I push it into the slot.
Yeah.
And I'll shut it down to there. Do you think I should press the button?
Yeah, go for
it. All right. I press the button.
There is a sudden clunk, and the metal plate suddenly pulls it out of your grasp, and the sword goes into this thing. So yeah, the sword is in the wall. But as it does, and as it discharges, you see lightning suddenly like flash across these kind of wires that led up from the plate and around the top of this cavern and down into this door. And this is like a giant, almost like cog.
Mm.
And it kind of just goes back and it rolls to one side. And the captain says, he goes, yes! Yes, it was that! And then I walked over here and I touched this thing, and he goes to touch something, and there's this massive spark of electricity as he gets shocked and kind of like flies back across the room and is sat kind of looking a little bit dazed.
I run down because this is lightning, so I think this is a sign.
Mm-hmm.
So I run down and I touch exactly where he touched.
Oh, there's nothing.
I'm going to medicine the captain.
Sure, as you come up to him, he kind of suddenly gropes for a cutlass isn't there. Evangeline, no! You mustn't! And then seems to come to his tome and sort of like looks around. He's like, oh, good lord. Oh, well, that was peculiar. Ellie, right? And Alex and Natalie and Chris. And this is... not... is Evangeline here?
Oh dear.
No.
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 Good.
Good. Good.
I shouldn't trust her. Put a lot of trust in her. That didn't go well, but...
That's not going to be a problem.
Yeah, don't worry about that.
No, it's fine.
Good. We're, I left here. You found... You found them. And he just like jumps up and just runs through the door and goes, come on, you have to see this.
Ooh.
Oh, so we are.
So run.
Yeah. And as you run in and you run into this, this huge cavern, and inside the cavern there is like a pool of cloud, like just as the ocean outside. And sitting on that cloud is a huge ship. It's 5 masts. It's got a jetty that leads out to it. All of the look of it, it seems very similar to all of the technology around it. And it's just kind of like sat there. And he's like running and jumping onto it. It's like, I found it. And she wanted it for herself. So and we fought. And then, I don't know, I got her out. We closed the door. I got a shock. And then, I'm not... But we've got it! And he's going to run onto the boat and kind of like show you, and he kind of shows you around, and there's like racks of these cutlasses. There's all these kind of books, ancient old books. You go into the engine room, and what you see is beautiful. The mess is like the best kitchen in the world. There is nothing you could want. I mean, all of the supplies are pretty off. But
is it non-stick pans?
Oh, it's non-stick pans for days.
So excited.
Like, and you sort of like, there's all this kind of like, yeah, cookware that you've never seen. Alex, you are straight up to the top of the mast. It has at the top a little built-in telescope that pivots and runs on a little rail all the way around the outside, so you can get a full 360 degree thing. There is the most beautiful array of mops. There is also on the helm of this ship a hat. You probably wander up and
I do.
Yeah, throw away your old hat.
I take off my hat. I put on the new hat.
This is an incredible ship, and as you spend time kind of exploring it and getting to know it, the captain calls you back up onto deck, and you'll gather around the helm. And you guys are in awe, and he goes, you haven't seen the best bit yet. He is going to press a little button on the console just by the helm. And as he does, he's a massive smile on his face. As he does, the ship begins to sink beneath the cloud. And as you go beneath the cloud, these big shoots of kind of lightning stuff comes up and round and forms this kind of dome around you. And you can see ahead of you a hole leading out of the mountain. And he starts giving orders as the captain that he once was. Aww. So he starts, you know, climb the Isle of Man, the ribbing, boom, coming across. Helmsman Starkey, at the ready. Everybody else, prepare for the ride of your life. And he hits another button, and the ship just shoots through the cloud out of thing. Essentially, you come out within the bay where that kind of monster mm-hmm. thing was. You essentially shoot out up onto the thing, cresting almost like a dolphin back underneath the cloud. Mm-hmm. And you now have a ship that moves at incredible speed beneath the ocean.
Beneath the clouds.
And credits roll.
Yay!
Say what?
I mean, presumably we go back and we get
caught.
Yeah. Oh, that's up to you. You can, yeah, if you want.
Awesome.
I feel like a ship that size, you'd probably need a few more people to properly man it.
Yeah.
I think it is.
Begrudgingly.
Like, Cobb would be pretty interested. I think you'd feel bad if he didn't get it.
Yeah, I would.
Amazing. Yeah. Thank you, Richard.
Thank you, Richard.
You've been listening to Merely Role Players with Ellie, Nat, Starkey and Alex as themselves, sort of, playing a game designed and run by Strat using the Powered by the Apocalypse engine. I'm your producer, Matt. Many thanks to Smokey Bastard and their label Bomber Music for the use of this season's theme song, Mong Some Hoof, from the album Tales from the Wasteland. Go to bombermusic.com or search for more from Smokey Bastard on Spotify. If you enjoyed the programme, let us know with a review or rating on Apple Podcasts, Podchaser, Listen Notes, or wherever you do your listening. You can also find us on Twitter at Merely Roleplay and at facebook.com/merelyroleplayers. Merely Roleplayers is an independent production in association with Blackshaw Theatre Company. Join us for more drama next episode.